Hey, Justin.
What's up, man?
Not much. Just preparing to talk about Bill and Ted's excellent video game adventure on the Two Dudes and an S podcast.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy. I have a feeling that this is going to be a really good episode. There's lots to talk about. Not so much in relation to the game.
Right.
And I apologize to the Patreon donor there that whose name has all of a sudden escaped me, but I will figure it out here in a moment.
Timmy Mac.
Timmy. That's right. I should have known that.
Timmy Mac pulled this one up, and spoiler alert, I'm not sure he's a huge fan of it either, but anyway.
Okay, we'll get there. We'll get there.
Yeah, we'll get there.
I will say, Timmy. Good. And this is not just Timmy. Timmy just happens to be the one under the bus right now. This goes out to all of you guys donating to us on Patreon. And are suggesting games for us to play. And I appreciate the donations. I really do. But it's been a while since any of you guys gave us just a real quality game to play. I think may have been Andrew or Dude Drubacco with the Shadow of the Ninja. That was pretty good.
Yeah.
And then we had The Legend of Zelda recommended, which was amazing. But other than that, I feel like I've just been kind of digging ditches.
It's, me and you were texting about this earlier, kind of having this conversation about this. And I think we kind of came to the conclusion, much to the disappointment of probably Dude Vanderhoff. But when we do bad games, we do more tangents.
Yeah, and people may like
the tangent. They're just picking bad games, so we'll do more tangents.
Well, I got plenty of tangents for this
Me
episode.
Too. Okay. And so we were talking before the show about guns and gun safety.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was a local church in a local town that's a very small town. Not the town that either one of us live in. But it's known to be quite small and quite, what's the politically correct way to say this?
Rural?
Very, very rural and very country. And so there was a call, I was at the hospital, I guess there was a call about, they thought there was a shooting in a church, and in this town, which would be a big deal, because how in the world would that be going on?
It would be basically everybody in the town.
Yeah. And, that is fresh. Hold on, sorry. So anyway, it turns out what happens is this guy's, like, got his gun in the church. And he's pulling it out and kind of showing it off to everybody, as one does at church.
Of course.
I mean, right.
I mean, if it's a really nice gun, I mean, you can't just keep it to yourself.
Right. It ends up shooting himself and his wife.
Huh.
It shoots his wife in the stomach. And it shoots his, I don't know if it was two bullets or one bullet. I don't really know all the details. But somehow he shoots himself in the arm and his wife in the stomach. So I don't know if, like, he was like... but anyway, long story short, he said he didn't intend to shoot himself.
Didn't say anything about his wife.
Yeah, no, I'm just joking. He didn't say that.
That's like a Letterman bit right there.
Yeah, right, yeah. But yeah, so it was like, yeah.
Speaking of, I just got my time to renew your handgun carry permit letter.
Oh.
I probably shouldn't have just brandished that in front of the camera. I hope there's nothing.
I couldn't
like, really,
see anything.
I know, but, you know, internet sleuths out there. Somebody's going to freeze frame that and just...
Mm-hmm.
Know my address or something.
Yeah.
So I may edit that out of the behind the scenes. Anyways, got that. And so when I first got my handgun carry permit, I was dumb and I did not get the lifetime version.
Oh boy.
And so now I have the opportunity to get the lifetime version, but I feel like I just wasted like $100 the last two times I renewed it.
Right.
So now I'm sitting here
thinking, like 2 years?
It was two. And now this year they upped it to 8, so you only have to renew it every 8 years, or you can get a lifetime. And since I've had it since I was like 25, I could have saved like two renewals by now, you know?
Right.
and by getting a lifetime one. But who knows? And I got to go get another picture, which means I have to go to the DMV, which is really frustrating.
Yeah.
I haven't changed. I look the same, but yet I got to get another picture. But the good thing about it is if I get another picture for the handgun carry permit, I don't have to get a picture when my license comes due because they use the same picture. So I only have to go to the DMV once, and it covers both my licenses.
Yeah, but... Okay.
They're pretty much in line with each other, almost.
Okay.
Pretty close in line. Because I got my picture made when I got my handgun carry permit initially. So... It was 2 years, and then two more years, and then this will be like the 6th year. So every 5 years you got to get a new picture for your driver's license. I think it is every 5 years.
You got to get it renewed every 5 years. I don't know if you got to get a new picture. I don't know. I don't work for the DMV.
Works for the DMV, let me know. I know last time I went to get my license renewed, and they were going to get. They said we don't have to get a picture because you got a picture made 2 years ago or something like that. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're tied together. That's all I know. So hopefully this will prevent me from having to go get a picture made more frequently than I have to.
What do you think about this?
Okay.
Another tangent on top of this tangent.
All right.
Because I just thought about it because we're talking about renewing your driver's license. So I think, I think that we should... So there's this big question about would more people be organ donors, but they just don't think about being an organ donor. So they never sign up to be an organ donor. Even though it's easy, it's super easy to do when you go get your license or just do it online or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
What if we made organ donation an opt out? Like you had to opt out.
Okay.
When you went to get your license. If you didn't opt out, you're donating your organs. So, I mean, it would be upfront about it. I'm not saying, try to secretly, make people, but, basically, when you're, give them a piece of paper that says you will be an organ donor unless you choose to not be. If you choose to not be, click this X or whatever.
Yeah.
And make it blatant. Don't make it to where it's, in the mix of, a big, user agreement that nobody reads or anything, Just I really think that people, if they had, if it was just a pre-checked option, that we would have a lot more people to just do it. Not necessarily because they wouldn't realize they were doing it, just because if it was a pre-checked option, people would just do it more.
I think you're right about that. But I also think that you would, and now you answer me this question. Do stupid people also have stupid organs? Because I think it would probably skew more to having more stupid organs in the pool. Okay.
But I think it'd just be the brain. And we're not doing anything with the brain.
Sure. It might just be the stupid brain, but stupid people also do stupid things to their body, mess up their organs. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, do you really want the guy? No, hear me out. Do you really want the guy drinking Mountain Dew every day? Do you really want his liver being donated to people?
Well, it depends.
Dew guy.
It depends. How bad is my liver?
That's true. I mean, I guess.
Yeah.
But what if, let's say you need a liver transplant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mountain Dew man gets in a car wreck, dies, and you get his liver. Okay. And then you wake up in the hospital bed, and all of a sudden you got to have a mountain. You're dying for a Mountain Dew. And then you become a diabetic. Yeah. And then you got to get a kidney transplant one day. And then, you know what I'm saying? You hear me?
Yeah. Okay.
I don't know. I'm an organ donor.
Well, whatever.
By choice.
Yeah.
So we need to get rolling on this show before Timmy cuts off his donation money. But one more thing about the organ donation. And the dumb people and the smart people and all this stuff. What is people's... Is it the people who knowingly opt out? Are they people who are just afraid they're going to need their organs when they're dead? Or is it like they're afraid that the doctors are going to like pull the plug early so they can have the organs? I think I'm a little bit concerned about that. Like, what if there's like an unethical doctor that really wants to save this person's life? And then
the good thing is when it comes down to that decision, it's not one doctor's decision. So this is a decision made by a team. And
what if it's a team of evil doctors, like,
and
Mega Man boss
state's
doctors?
Donor service actually has to approve it and come in and talk to the family and everything. So it would have to be a very elaborate unethical scheme to, in order to get that to go underway.
Okay.
But yeah, anyway.
Okay.
Go ahead. I don't have a but.
Okay.
No, but
do you have any history?
Maybe. maybe. Go ahead.
Also, just so that we don't forget some of our awesome tangents, I have a really good poop tangent for later. I don't want to go ahead and we're already like 15 minutes in. We haven't even started on the game, so I'll save the poop tangent for later when we start running out of things to talk about in the game. But let's go ahead and get into history.
All right, so Bill and Ted's Excellent Video Game Adventure. It's an action-adventure video game that is part of the Bill and Ted franchise. Of course, based on Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure movie that was released in 1989. Although this game didn't get released until 1991. The publisher, who else would it be? It's a movie, it's a video game about a movie. Our good friends at LJN. And, of course, LJN has a notorious reputation for video game production. They've made multiple video games about movies. We've talked about a lot of them. We talked about Jaws. We've talked about Nightmare on Elm Street. We have talked about... What else have we talked about that they've done?
Friday the 13th.
Yeah.
We talked about that one.
Uh-huh. Roger Rabbit.
Was that LJN?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I kind of like that game, though, I think.
Wait, maybe.
It was also like Jaws, so I guess it could be. Anyways.
Yeah, but yeah. I feel like the Jaws thing is just...
That's a nostalgia play right there. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe they didn't do Roger Rabbit. I don't think they did Roger Rabbit. Hold on just 1 minute, okay?
All right.
I don't... Yeah, they did do Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Okay. All right. So,
there's two that you kind of like, right?
Yeah.
From LJN.
Yeah, I can give them two so far.
Yeah. So LJN, of course, produced this game, and it was released to actually mixed reviews at the time. It got a 3.6 out of 5 from the Nintendo Power. So, and a couple other like Honest Gamers gave the game a 4 out of 10. But then later reviews that would come later in Game Pro give it pretty negative reviews. One thing that the game does have is the game has music within game levels that
kind of.
We'll get to that later. But some of it is actually from like actual songs, like The Medieval World uses Scarborough Fair by Simon and Garfunkel.
I didn't notice that.
The Modern World uses Won't You Come Home, Bill Bailey by Harry Connick Jr.
Hey,
and the Ancient World uses Deep Purple's Smoke on the Water.
Nice.
So a little bit of music that was actually based off of real songs. One thing about Bill and Ted's is the Nintendo Power had a contest or a drawing for a promotion for the game, and they gave away the actual phone booth from the movie Bill and Ted's.
What?
As a contest prize.
Nice.
And the lucky winner was Kenneth Grayson.
And yeah, I know Ken.
You know Ken?
Yeah.
I'm going to pull up a picture of Ken here so that you can at least see him.
Well, I know. I already said I know.
Yeah. Maybe. Share screens. Here we go. All right. Start. All right. You see Ken here?
Yeah. Hey,
so
Ken.
So there he is going into his phone booth that he's won, which is the actual phone booth.
Is he wearing
booth.
A cat shirt?
I don't really know what that shirt is. Blue and pink. He's got his pants hiked up a little bit.
He looks like one of the brothers from Step by Step.
He does. He looks like Mark.
Yeah, Mark. That's right.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, Kenneth Grayson, he actually was tracked down by Reddit in 2011. And they had him do a Ask Me Anything on Reddit. But it kind of took a turn for the worse in that most of the time people just asked him if he'd ever done like anything dirty in the
which of course I'm sure he did.
It went south quite quickly,
as it usually does on the Reddit AMA.
I got a little bit of actual Bill and Ted's history.
Okay.
That you might be interested in.
Of course I am.
So there was originally when the three characters characters were wrote by the guys that wrote the movie, it was originally three characters, supposed to be Bill and Ted and Bob. But the guy that was like supposed to be Bob wasn't really into it because it was made in like an improv group at UCLA. And so the third guy wasn't really into it, so they just dropped the Bob part of the act. And
was the improv group? It wasn't the actors, was it? Was it Keanu Reeves and
No. It was UCLA classmates Ed Solomon and Chris Matheson.
Okay.
But Solomon played Ted, Matheson played Bill. And then when they were actually casting the parts, Keanu Reeves wanted to be Bill. He auditioned to be Bill, and the other guy, Alex Winter, wanted to be Ted. But they switched him.
They said, nope.
Yep.
Sorry. Not going to happen.
And none other than Pauly Shore wanted to be Ted. So what would...
Good.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually, although I don't know, Keanu Reeves is pretty iconic.
It's pretty good.
As Ted. If they wanted to bring Bob back in the picture and have Pauly Shore there as Bob,
I could go
for that. Now, the third movie that has supposedly been in the works for years and years and years, is that happening that you know of? And if it is, can we bring Pauly Shore in as Bob?
I don't know, and maybe.
Okay. All right. That's fair.
Did you know that the time machine was originally going to be a van?
No, but that sounds very fitting. But I bet Back to the Future screwed that up, didn't it?
That's exactly why they rewrote it, because Warner Brothers thought that it was too close to a ripoff to Back to the Future.
I could see that.
And the script was written in 4 days. Solomon and Matheson wrote the script in 4 days, and they wrote it up by hand.
Wow. I was about to say, it sounds like they used a lot of copy and paste from what I remember from the movie.
Yeah.
Just a lot of excellence and dudes and stuff. Mm-hmm. But if they wrote it by hand, then guess maybe not.
Yeah. So anyway, that's about all the history I got. Hey, you got any big, long story about how you went and found it?
No, let me open this package here.
<Real quick>. The package that the game's in.
Yeah, it's in a package. You hear me open it?
so that sound is my 2-year-old daughter Ella, who is it is 11, almost 11:10 here as we record this, and she's still going strong. So can't get her to go to sleep.
It's all that Monster you put in her bottle.
It's true.
Monster energy drink. You should probably. You know,
Mountain Dew.
Stop that about
aforementioned Mountain Dew.
You should stop the Mountain Dew in the bottle at around 2:00 in the afternoon.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they're up all night.
Right.
Anyway,
did you find this game? Did you go on a big quest, an excellent adventure?
Went on a most excellent adventure to find this game, and by that I mean I got it from Pick and Flick back in the day.
Woo!
Yeah. I remember I rented it from Pick a Flick a few times as a kid and honestly didn't really like it. And then I don't know why, but when Pick a Flick started selling off their NES games, I guess I thought I'd give it another shot. I bought it. It's one of those things, and I'm sure people out there, and you may maybe can have the same sensation, but you don't really like something, but you're familiar with it, so you buy it.
Right.
And that seems like a dumb thing to do, which it kind of is. I wish I hadn't have done it somewhat throughout the years. I've had my regrets, but, it was familiar to me. I had played it. It was on sale. So there you go. I bought it from Pick a Flick.
Just had to have it.
Just had to have it. I don't know why. I just did.
Yeah. Wow. Well, did you like the movies? Were you a big Bill
I was
Ted
a
fan?
Huge fan of the movies, especially the second one, The Bogus Journey.
Oh, really?
Yes. Because now, you may be a bigger fan of the first one, I don't know, or neither of them. I don't know how you feel about them. But for me, the scene when they die in the second movie and they go down to, and Death is there and they mm-hmm. play him in like board games to get out of hell. That is just like, that still to me is one of the funniest concepts and like just scenes in any movie that I've seen. I just think it's hilarious. And the guy that plays Death and just the way Death acts is just, it just cracks me up.
Yeah.
I still watch that part. The movies as a whole, they don't hold up too well for me, but just that one part when they go down to hell and face Death, it's crazy. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you seen the movie? You've seen the movie, right?
Yeah, I've seen the movie. I just, to me, I've never been a huge fan of them for some reason. I've just never really gotten into them that much.
Well, I don't know why. As a kid, I liked them. I think it was because all the surfer speak kind of reminded me of Ninja Turtles. And I
wanted to be
a
surfer.
Fan.
Everybody wanted to be a surfer. Everybody wanted to be that type of
Which
dude.
I don't know why. Sulfur, stinky. No.
Yeah.
Surfer. I cannot.
I get, yeah, surfer. Get, yeah, surfer.
Surfer culture. That's it. I'm editing this entire episode out. We're starting over. No, I'm just kidding.
Mm-hmm.
The culture around surfing is dumb, is what I'm trying to get at.
Yeah. Dumb guys.
Yeah.
Right?
But dumb, even if they're not dumb, they make themselves sound dumb on purpose.
Have you seen the surfer guy talking about, I don't even remember what he was talking about in front of the city council. It was a YouTube video, kind of went viral there for a while, maybe a year or two ago. It was pretty funny. I'll have to find it and send it to you. It's like he was trying to get a city council to like build a statue for somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't remember who it was for, but it was hilarious. But
okay,
yeah,
good story.
Yeah, it's a great story, huh? Yeah,
and then he like stabbed some guy in the face or something.
Paul Walker. Yeah, that's what it is. Okay,
he wanted to build a statue for Paul Walker.
Yeah.
Okay,
but it's hilarious because it's just like a surfer dude trying to talk to city council about Paul Walker. So
that does sound pretty funny.
Yeah. So you should look it up.
Okay. I'll look it up. Yeah. Was it real heartfelt? Did he start getting teary eyed?
It was heartfelt from a
surfer dude's
from
perspective.
A surfer. Yeah.
That does sound pretty funny.
So.
All right. So we should probably talk about the game. Remind me, I know I've already talked, I got one poop tangent, but remind me, I also got another Patreon tangent I want to go on later.
Okay. So,
and then I want to talk about our next episode, which is going to be a Christmas episode, but I'm not exactly sure how we're going to do it.
Okay.
Oh, and also, the results are in for the holiday pie contest.
Oh.
We got a lot of voicemails about that. So I'm just letting everybody know that even though this game conversation may be a bit of a dud, stick around because we got lots of good stuff coming up.
All right.
You
will not be disappointed.
No. All right. So let's talk about this game. Now, like I said, I mentioned that I played it as a kid, rented it from Pick a Flick all the time. Not all the time, maybe twice, but both times could never figure anything out and hated it with a passion. So that is my memory from my childhood in regards to this game. Did you play it when you were a child?
Did not play it as a child. Like I said, again, wasn't a big Bill and Ted's fan growing up. You know, back when the Bill and Ted's movies were famous.
Yeah.
And now, so I certainly didn't have any reason to really want to play the game. So this was my first experience with the game.
Okay.
And I'm just going to throw this out there.
All right. You want to throw this out there before or after we read from the manual?
Let me just throw this out there before the manual. Okay. Because the manual may or may not alleviate some of this pain.
Okay.
But I didn't know what the heck was going on. Like, I didn't know what I was supposed to do. I was confused. At times you could walk on grass. At times you could certainly not walk on grass. I didn't know what was going on.
I can't. Just to throw this out there, I could not make heads or tails of the very beginning of the game. Like, they give you the story. I know we're just skipping over the manual right here, but I just I got to get into it, okay? Because this is just, okay. You start the game. They give you a story. Rufus is there. He's talking to Ted. He says, hey, you and Bill got to work separately, which sucks, first of all, because it's Bill and Ted.
Right.
They're never separate at all in any of the movies. And then here they are, this entire game is separate. So first of all, that sucks.
Yeah.
And don't give me this malarkey about how you can't do it properly where you play as two characters. Plenty of games did it. Right. You could have them following each other where you can switch back and forth between them. You could do it like the original Ninja Turtles game where you switch back and forth. I don't care. You could have done it. That's first. First and foremost, that's a gripe for me. Second of all, after you get the story, you're presented with a phone book, okay? With a lot of phone numbers. Okay, sweet. Right. I assume I'm supposed to call one of these. Maybe I get to choose which one I want to call because I can flip through the book and I got tons of numbers. Maybe I just choose which one I want, kind of like a Mega Man style game where I get to choose which boss to go to. So what do? I flip through, find Elvis, because Elvis is the one that I would most like to go after first. So I try to call Elvis. Can't figure out how to dial his number. It's just not working for me. I pick up my cell phone. I start dialing the number on my cell phone. Doesn't work.
I
thought maybe this was like a super futuristic game where you actually had to dial the number.
Yeah.
Maybe I pulled the house phone out, dialed it on the rotary dial at the house. You know? Could not figure it out. Until finally, there's the one that you flip to, and it's like blinking red. As in, this is the guy you have to go to first.
Okay? Yeah.
So finally, I think, okay, yeah, cool. I'm finally figuring this out. You have to actually dial the number.
Which it makes an entire mini game out of, which is a horrible mini game.
It's the worst. Okay, first of all, you dial the number, which, okay, I can get over that. You type the number in using the using the pad or whatever, the D-pad. And then you go into this screen where you are the phone booth. Sort of. I couldn't really figure out how to control it. You control like a circle on the screen.
And you're like trying to bounce it and direct it.
I don't know. You tell me. I honestly could not figure it out. What happened? What I did, here's my approach. My first approach was I would put the circle where I wanted the phone booth to go. Okay. I'll put the circle where I want the phone booth to go and I would hit the button. And the phone booth would go off in a completely different direction.
Yeah.
It would not go where I wanted it to go.
Right.
And so finally I figured out, oh, okay. What I'm supposed to do is point or hit the button when the phone booth faces the direction I want to go.
Ah.
And then that's the direction it's going to go. So it spins in a circle. And then when it points where you want it to go, that's when you hit the button. Okay.
And And again, there's so much direction in this game, so easy to figure out, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And so I did this for a while. And you're supposed to be aiming at numbers. I guess you're supposed to be dialing it on that screen, which by this time, I've completely forgotten what the number is.
Sure.
So even though there's numbers on the screen, I don't know what order to go to them in.
Mm-hmm.
So I just tried to go in the order that they were on the little pipe in the pipes. But the pipes are such a nasty spider web of gunk that you can't tell where what's going where anyways.
Right. Eventually just wait and don't do anything, it'll dial it itself, but then it takes away more coins if it does that. Even more ridiculous.
So stupid. Okay.
Yeah.
Side note, this is completely unrelated to the game, but it is related to the podcast. My computer just did something weird where it kind of did like this freezy thing. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if it recorded the last like 2 minutes of our conversation. If it didn't, and you're listening to this now, and I forgot to edit it, and you missed there's a 2 minute gap. I'm sorry. I don't know what happened. Yeah. It was just us ranting about how terrible this mini game is, going through the phone numbers.
Yeah.
So anyway, okay. So you can just leave it alone. See, what happened to me was I think it just got tired of me trying and just said, "Here, fine."
Yeah.
Because right. I literally was trying to do what it wanted me to do for, I don't know, however long you're allowed to try. Because I did not figure anything out. Every now and then I would land on a skull and it would just boop, knock me out of the way. I just take coins away for no reason.
Yeah.
And I played this past weekend and a little bit before. And also apologies for the slight delay on the podcast. I've been sick. And I got another tangent about that too. But anyways, so I played it this past weekend, a little bit the last week or so. And I've really kind of tried to give this game its fair shake, but, I was by myself, luckily, because if my wife had been home or if Teeter, my dog, had been home, I don't know what they would have thought, because I was sitting there playing. I was trying to figure out that phone booth part, and I literally was sitting there trying to figure it out. And out loud, I went, "Oh, I can't stand this. This is the most frustrating, stupid thing I've ever done."
Yeah. Yeah.
Anyways, I hated that part with a passion. So
yeah.
So anyways, quick tangent, because I'm getting frustrated here talking about this game. I've been sick. They gave me antibiotics, which I typically don't like to take, but I wanted to get over the sickness quickly because I had too much stuff to do at work. I couldn't miss a day. So they gave me antibiotics. They gave me a ton of antibiotics. And the doctor was very adamant to tell me, "You have to take all of these antibiotics."
Sure.
Why is that? Is it going to come back at me with a vengeance if I don't take every one of the antibiotics?
So by not completing antibiotics, it can lead. That's not Cool Whip. That's not cool.
Do we want to know what it really is?
Bring it to me and I'll show you. It's leftovers. Go put it up. Okay. Sorry about that.
The inquiring minds want to know what it really is.
It's
oh, it's just like a Tupperware.
Yeah. You know, okay. Cool Whip gives you free Tupperware, right?
Yeah.
So, So if you have a number of bacteria in your body, right, that you're going to kill with this antibiotic, and you use that antibiotic for just a short period of time you don't complete the antibiotic. So these time periods you're supposed to take antibiotics are set because that should be the time period that it takes to kill all the bacteria that's pathologic in your body. Okay. By only taking a short period of time, you can kill enough to where it basically gets your body over the illness that's created by the bacteria, but a certain number will survive, and those that will survive
will be stronger,
have been exposed but have not been killed, so they can become more resistant and become even actually resistant to the antibiotic. Then you get these resistant bacteria, and that they can propagate, grow, and spread. And that's how you get antibiotic resistance, or one of the ways.
And they could go to somebody else, and then they would not be able to use my antibiotics against those bacteria.
Or yourself.
Yeah. Well, that's also probably why whenever they gave me the antibiotics, since I got this nastiness from my wife, they would not give me the same antibiotics that she was on.
Yeah.
Because once whatever it was came to me, it could have had a resistance to the antibiotics, perhaps.
Maybe.
Okay, yeah, I'll keep taking these nasty gigantic horse pills for.
What are you taking? Augmentin? You taking amoxicillin?
Amoxicillin.
Yeah. Clavulinic acid. Clavulinate. Yeah. So, all right.
They're big. That's all I know.
Yep.
Horse. Hey, pills. There's the train that was just at your house. I think is at my house now.
Oh, well, there you go. Train.
There we go. That's how we know it's going to be a good episode.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Back to the game. So we haven't even made it to the main part of the game, which is the part where you actually get to be Bill and or Ted.
Right.
You're searching for the historical dude or dudette.
Right. And you got to find stuff to give them.
Mm-hmm.
And
you
got
to bait them.
Right. Which sounds ridiculous. But when you get the historical bait, it's always something kind of odd to give to the person.
Yeah, but it matches, like, if you're familiar with the Bill and Ted style, it matches what Bill and Ted would try to use to bait these guys with. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but I don't know.
I do appreciate that.
Yeah, except I get most of them. Like the Caesar dressing for Julius Caesar. Okay, I get that. But what about the Elvis just giving him a tombstone?
Yeah, that's a little weird. I've got a bunch of trophies for this episode, by the way, retrofitted trophies.
Okay.
And a lot of them are related to what you give the historical dude to bait them out.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, most of them pretty much make sense. But yeah. a few of them are a little strange.
Yeah.
And don't make any sense at all. Like, one of the things is the whole point of the game and the Bill and Ted movies is you're trying to prevent, like, the future from changing too much because Bill and Ted are supposed to be, like, the saviors of the future. Mm-hmm. So they're always worried about something happening to Bill and Ted in the past that would prevent them from being the saviors of the future.
Yeah.
And so that's part of the game, too. But yet, a lot of these items you give them are things that would just completely alter the timeline of events in the world, you know?
Right.
Like, I think Al Capone, you're supposed to give him, like, a law book or something so that he doesn't go to jail.
Yeah.
Which would completely change the course of that timeline, right?
And you also give Jesse James and Uzi.
the most notorious guys in the Wild West. One of the most notorious gunslingers in the Wild West, give him a fully automatic weapon.
Yeah.
That's smart.
Yeah.
Yeah. The game itself is a top-down, kind of Zelda-like game in a way, where you have an attack and a jump. The attack is dependent on what kind of weapon you have, which is typically some kind of a thrown weapon, like a grenade. It's almost like a grenade.
But it's either pudding
or it's
a textbook.
Like an exploding textbook. You know, well, like your average textbook.
Right.
Have you ever thrown a textbook? They just explode.
Right. So, it reminds me of Tales from the Far Side, Exploding Kids.
Yeah.
What is it? Is it Bob's Exploding Kids?
It's something like that, yeah.
Yeah, it's hilarious.
I love that show. We need to, Halloween Patreon.
Next 2018. Yeah.
Of 2018. We need to do Tales from the Far Side because I love that. Both of them are good, but the first one's the best.
Oh, it's so good.
Okay, so.
But anyway.
I know you, first of all, you don't like top-down things at all anyways, right?
Yeah. Well, this is kind of not. This was weird. It's almost like a mixture of a top-down, like, platformer, because it's at an angle, right? So it's an angled view. And
it's like a three-quarters.
Purely, it's almost kind of a semi-side-scrolling feel at the same time.
It's pretty action-y.
Yeah. But so the first level. Let's just cut this into the first level. And it's Rembrandt. Right, so Rembrandt's level. So you're like in this looks medieval, like time period. And you're, you know, the song plays. You're like, well, okay, I actually like this song.
Yeah.
And this was, and I'm playing it before I know that it's Simon and Garfunkel's Scarborough Fair song. Uh-huh. I was like, oh, this music's pretty good.
Yeah.
And then about 20 seconds later, there's no more music.
Gone. It's gone. It just stops. It's like they forgot to hit the repeat button on the.
Yeah, it's just like they got lazy and just said, nah, that's enough.
Although, can you imagine if, okay, let's say that they just hit the repeat button on that 20 seconds. Can you imagine how old that would get?
How quick
it would get old.
Yeah, that's true.
But they could have made a longer song, maybe. I don't know. It is the music in this game, while the 20-second snippets are good, it is extremely lazy because that's all you get, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll get a little bit of music, and then it'll stop, and then you're listening to nothing but sound effects the rest of the time.
Yeah. And the sound effects aren't that great.
No, it's just a lot of whoop, whoop, whoop.
Yeah. Yeah. It's that. And I always feel like games that don't have music is like awkward silence. It's just like, you know, there's something missing.
Yeah. If the people listening to this on the audio podcast version, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to just give them a taste of what the awkwardness is going to be like. And we may lose a few listeners on this episode because I'm going to start it. Normally I have the music come in and then fade away and then just play in the background while we talk. On this episode, I think I'm going to have it play and then stop. And then we give it like 5 seconds and then we start talking and there's no more music for the rest of the show. Right. Just to give you an idea of how this game feels when it comes to music.
Yeah, it's so bad. I just don't like that at all. And I understand that it might get old if you repeated it, but I would much rather have it repeat.
Yeah. Okay, to answer me this then, because we can kind of understand the music not continuing on because they didn't want to repeat it or whatever, but explain to me why you have this giant, well, somewhat giant, it's not really giant, but this big open world kind of, for these big open levels.
Mm-hmm.
Which is cool because, you know, you can walk, you'd think you could walk around, find the things to bait the people with, find the people, bait them, walk around the whole world, and do all this stuff. But no, false, because you can't get off the path without falling on your butt.
Yeah.
You just.
And then you can't even get up.
No, you can't get up and walk back to the path. You have to like jump back to the path.
Yeah.
And then every time you land, you fall back down.
Yeah, it's you finally get to the end of the path, and you hesitate, because it's like, should I go back? Because now it's like a fence that you're supposed to jump over onto grass, which you've previously been told, no grass. It's like seeing the keep off grass sign, like 20 feet ago. And then now you've got grass that doesn't have keep off grass sign. Uh-huh. You're trying to think, is that sign still in play?
Right. This game, okay, here's exactly what this game is. And I'm sure we've talked about other games that have done this in the past, but this game is the perfect example of a game that constantly changes the rules while you're playing it. Like, you never know what the rules of the game are.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Like, to go back to the little section where the camera, or not the camera, the telephone booth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The telephone booth section, the entire time you're playing it, for the most part, skull equals bad. Skull takes away your coins. Takes away your coins. Okay. Oh, but wait. Does purple skull take away your coins? Or does purple skull mean you need to land on it?
Depends on which one you hit.
Depends on which purple skull it is. It's so stupid.
It's just annoying.
The rule, like I said, the rules are constantly changing, so you never really know exactly what you're supposed to do. Other than you're supposed to be trying to find these historic dudes.
I know we've talked about this before with LJN games, but every LJN game just feel like so lazy, and just they made the game just to sell and make product for a movie. You know, it's just, there's just things in it that are just, you just have to say that's just lazy, you know? So.
I know. I agree. Well, I mean, I don't know how frequently they were putting out games. It feels like they put out a lot of games. So maybe they were just churning them out too fast to really focus on any one game or something. I don't know what it is, but I tell you, this game is sloppy.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope when we get to the feedback, Timmy is not like a huge fan of this game, because this game to me is in the running to dethrone Deadly Towers, because I had almost as little to no fun playing this game.
It's pretty bad. So
there are a lot of redeeming qualities about some of the other LGN games, but I could only find one redeeming quality about this game.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the graphics. I actually did like the graphics of the top-down area. I thought the Bill and Ted characters, the sprites for Bill and Ted, were spot on. Like, I think that was about as good as you could do on the NES for a Bill and a Ted. I thought they were perfect.
Yeah.
The bad guys were kind of monotonous a little bit, but the levels themselves looked pretty good. They're very colorful. I could always tell which was the path and which was not the path. I didn't know whether or not I could walk on them, but I always knew which one was which. So I thought the graphics were pretty good.
The sprites were good for the bait, as well as the historical figures. I think you could tell pretty much which ones were which by looking at all of them. Although Al Capone kind of looks like Michael Jackson from Smooth Criminal.
Yeah,
so
he does. Well, in his defense, Michael Jackson kind of looks like Al Capone in Smooth Criminal.
Except Al Capone was fat, morbidly obese. But anyway.
Right. Are we talking about the same Michael Jackson?
How many Michael Jacksons?
Oh, wait, no, I'm thinking of Weird Al from the I'm Fat video.
Okay.
Yeah, easy mistake.
And as an insult to injury, especially something that gets talked about a lot nowadays, Christopher Columbus kind of looks like a Native American. So.
Yeah, okay. Well, I never said the graphics were great. I just said they were good.
I didn't say, I'm just saying. Anyway. You want to talk about the manual? You want to bring out the manual?
Let me bring the manual back out. The manual is actually really nice.
Yeah.
I just swiped it away. But it came back, don't worry. The manual looks pretty good. It's got the movie art there. Mm-hmm. Got a Butterfinger on the back cover.
Right, Butterfinger ad.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this second page, they're already lying.
Which page?
Where it talks about the Nintendo official seal of quality.
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure Nintendo actually continued with the seal of quality past about 1989.
Yeah. This official seal is your assurance that Nintendo has reviewed this product and it has met our standards of excellence in workmanship, reliability, and entertainment value.
False.
It's true. Yeah.
All right. So this manual is really dense, like really, really dense. Mm-hmm. But it is actually, in looking at it, I wish I would have read it prior to playing the game, because it actually, just looking at it here at a glance, it is really helpful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I would say to telling you how to play the game. So, might I recommend that if for some reason you're listening to this conversation that we're having, and you're thinking that game sounds pretty good, I think I want to try it. might I recommend you go to the manual first before you play it? You laugh. Why?
What?
This just seems like an impossibility.
We've done nothing but say nothing but bad things about the game, and you're like, hey, this sounds pretty good. I think I'm going to try it out.
Somebody out there might be thinking that, because we did say that the Bill and Ted sprites were spot on.
Yeah. Could be a game that could be all they need.
So I'm not going to spend too much time on the manual, other than to say that it is a quality manual. That may be the best part about this game. It's got a good manual.
Yeah. Good manual. Kind of tells you what you got to know. So.
Yep.
There you go.
All right.
If you do want to play this game, read the manual.
Yes. Agreed. So, now comes the segment where we say, is it worth it? How much does it go for? And would you replace anything on your $118 list?
I don't care how much it's worth. It's not replacing anything.
No, it's not.
So if it's a cent and I could just add it to it because I don't have I've not reached the $118 mark, I'm still not adding it.
Not putting it on the list, even if it doesn't even cost you another game.
I don't have to remove anything. You know, I can't. Like, I'm just looking at it, just kind of a. All I'm finding is factory sealed versions.
Well, everybody who has it used is always playing it. They don't ever want to sell it.
Maybe. Here we go.
Good price chart.
Here we go. Here we go. I got you.
All right, you got me.
Let's just say it's about $10.
Wow. Yeah, no, that's not worth it.
Not worth it. Not replacing anything.
No, not worth it, and it's not replacing anything on my list either.
Yeah.
I don't know. If you're like the biggest Bill and Ted fan ever, and you just got to have all the memorabilia and everything Bill and Ted related,
mm-hmm.
I'd still be hard-pressed to get this game.
Right.
Unless maybe it's signed by Bill and Ted. Like, if Keanu Reeves had this signed and I was a big Bill and Ted fan, then maybe I would get it.
Yeah.
Still wouldn't pay more than $10 for it, though.
They've made an iPhone 10 snap case out of the Bill and Ted's Excellent Video Game Adventure.
Really?
Box art. So there you go.
Okay, well, the box art is the same as the movie poster, I believe. So maybe it's just...
Yeah, it just says video game.
Oh, it does,
and it's,
yeah.
And it's lazily put in with, like, what's the thing, the little triangle that you put in if you want to add, like, a word or something? Something? I don't know what it's called. Know. You know, if you're, like, reviewing a paper and you want to add something, you know?
Oh, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
They've just done that and said...
It's a little hat.
Video game. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. It's the only difference. So.
Well, I don't know, man.
Yeah, what are you going to do, right?
I don't know. Well... On that note, do you want to hear my poop story?
I do.
Okay. So, I was trying to go to the bathroom. Okay. Number two.
Mm-hmm.
So, let's just say I was at Walmart.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And there was one stall at Walmart.
Mm-hmm.
So, I go in. There's somebody in there. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm like, okay. I kind of got to go, but I can hold it for a little bit. So I went back and did some more shopping. And I come back to check it again. Somebody's still in there. Things are getting a little heated now. So I'm starting to get frustrated. Somebody's still in there. I don't know if it's the same person. I don't know if it's
another
person.
Are they on their phone? What are they doing?
Maybe they're just wasting time on their phone. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm starting to get frustrated. Things are going to have to happen pretty soon. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'm going to have to leave the store and go to another store. You know what I'm saying? Anyways, that happens. Go back, shop some more. I come back. It's open. I'm thinking, thank goodness. Finally, my turn. My time to shine. This is my turn. So I go in. Keep in mind, one stall. I can't be the only one experiencing this, you know?
Right.
There's got to probably be other people that are going in, trying to use the bathroom, and this guy is playing on his phone or something.
Right.
Okay, so go in. My time to shine. I sit down, not waste any time because I'm considerate, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I know that it's only one stall, so I'm trying to hurry so nobody else has to experience this. And while I'm in there, it's not been 30 seconds. Some guy comes in, wants to use the bathroom, has probably been in the same position that I have been in the last like 10, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, however long it's been. He comes in, he sees that I'm in there. Maybe he thinks I'm the other guy, but I can hear him like huffing and puffing and like getting all mad on the outside, like kind of pacing the bathroom a little bit. And then finally he leans down and like looks under the stall to see, like to see who I am. I guess.
What maniac is this?
Who is this crazy person? I know, right? He doesn't lean down far enough to look up in there and see me, but he leans down far enough to see my shoes so that I guess if once we're back out in the store, he can find me in my shoes and like come get me or something. I don't know. But literally, I had been in there for like 30 seconds, but I think he was so frustrated because he was in the same shoes that I was in.
Yeah.
And he thought that I was the guy that was in there just wasting all this time.
It would have been funny if when he looked down is if you'd picked your feet up.
That would have been great.
Oh, man. That no, is sad.
I wouldn't have picked my feet up because there's nothing I hate more than trying to go to the bathroom and take a crap and somebody's like grabbing at the door and like jiggling it, you know. It's like they come in, the stall shut, okay,
yeah.
But they're like, is anybody in there? Is anybody in there? Is anybody in there?
Yeah, I hate that. And I hate the when you're in the one holer bathroom and they shake the door handle and it's locked. Okay. Yeah. What does that mean?
It means move on. In there.
Move on. Yeah. And then they knock. And then I'm just like, I don't want to say anything because I'm like, okay, look, guy, I don't want to talk.
You should know. You should know, sir. You should know.
And then maybe 10, 15 seconds go by, knocks again. <It's> like, did you think somebody just appeared? Like, what?
Yeah. I know. That has happened to me at a porta potty before. I do not like doing the two at the porta potty.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to. And I can remember the last time that it happened to me, I was in the porta potty. The guy walks up. The porta potty's got the red symbol on it when it's occupied, right?
Yeah.
You shut the thing and it turns red. Like there's somebody in here. So he comes up and he tries to open it. Doesn't work. Okay. That's fine. And then he knocks and gets no response from me because I'm trying to, I'm in a porta potty. I don't want to talk to the person on the house. There's other people out there. It's not just you and me, sir. Okay. And then he says, anybody in there?
Where did he think you went? Did he think you went through the bottom of it and left? Like,
I don't know, but I did my response was the best response ever. I went, no.
I slipped out the back door of the porta potty. Like, what did you think happened? Oh, man.
I climbed out the roof. I swear, some people. Anyways.
And there's nothing worse. In going back to your original story, there's really nothing worse than having to take a deuce right after somebody finishes.
I know. The seat's still warm.
It smells horrible.
Feels so germy.
It smells horrible. And then your smell starts to add to it. And it's just like, this is just awful.
And you never know if your spices and that guy's spices are going to blend well together.
They're not going to
be like, no. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now that we've sufficiently grossed everyone out, how about we move on to retrofitted trophies?
All right.
I have several.
I have one.
Okay. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I went
a little
overboard.
You're just going to have to power through them.
Okay, I'll power through and then you can finish this off.
All right.
All right. My first one is Salad Dressing Dude, and that is Collect Julius Caesar. A lot of these are only going to really, they're really going to hit home for the people who are Bill and Ted movie fans. Maybe not so much anything else.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're not a big Bill and Ted movie fan, I may have to fill you in, Justin. Okay, the second one is Chasing Moby Dick, and that is Collect George Washington.
There you go.
Because in the movie, Ted mistakes George Washington for Captain Ahab.
Yeah.
Or Arab. That's Ahab, right? Ahab.
Yeah. Ahab.
Okay. Yeah. The next one I have is called Breaking the News, and that is Collect Elvis, because you basically tell him when he dies. Breaking the news to
him. This isn't going to be good, but here you go.
The next one I have is Bad Idea, and that is Collect Jesse James, because you give him an Uzi when you collect him. That's a bad idea. The next one I have is Prepping the Babe Report, and to prep the Babe Report, you have to collect Cleopatra and Marilyn Monroe. Mm. This one is, how about we just not discover America? And that is Collect Christopher Columbus, because you give him a compass. And I have a feeling that if Christopher Columbus knew which way he was going, he would have just went to the French Indies or wherever it was he was going to.
Right, exactly.
Would have discovered America. then I have one called Easy Questing. And to do Easy Questing, you collect King Arthur because you give him the Holy Grail. It's just like, it's only the thing he's been searching for his entire life.
Yeah, exactly.
And his entire life's mission. You just kind of hand it to him.
Yeah.
And then my last one is get out of jail free card. And that is collect Al Capone. Cause you give him, basically give him his law book that gets him out of jail free. Yeah. Or I assume it does. That's it.
But mine is, simply the turd trophy since we've had so much turd talk tonight. And that is just by playing the game. You win it.
Okay. All right.
There you go.
I did have one more, actually. It's just called Most Excellent, and that's just collecting all 16 historical dudes. I forgot about that one. But I like the turd trophy.
Yeah.
And the turd award goes to...
Timmy Mac.
Probably Timmy. Probably Timmy.
Yeah.
For suggesting this game.
Right.
Congratulations, Timmy. Wear it with pride.
Although Timmy did pull out a meme for us from our last Patreon, where we talked about the meme for about the fried Cheetos.
Yeah. He totally redeemed himself. I forgot about that, the Cheetos meme. So, never mind. Okay, well, I tell you what. You can have the Turd Award, and you can have the Tom Arnold Would Be Impressed Award for this episode.
There you go. Tom Arnold. He knows about us.
He does.
We're on his radar.
It's only a matter of time before he's on this podcast one way or another.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It may be a boxing match. It may be maybe a simple conversation. We don't know.
Fighting him. Oh, man. All right. So,
all right. How do you want to rate this? Man, I really like to rate it as a turd. We've already done that for Daily Towers. We really wasted that.
Yeah. Let's see.
We've already done vomit. What's another?
What's
another something terrible? You got email there.
Yeah, I know. And it's funny because like about 10 minutes ago, I was like, I'll just go ahead and turn it up, but I don't want to keep it on silent, you know, overnight. So. I'll just turn it on. Nobody's going to message me in the last, like, you know, it's 11:30 at night. Nobody's going to, nope. Keep getting messages. All right. Let's see. What can we talk about? What can we do? Bad movie?
Okay. Although this game is about a movie.
But it's not a bad movie.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, maybe not.
I can try to think of a bad movie. How about food? How about a food? Like a bad food? I'm sure we've done good food before. How about like just a bad food?
All right.
Yeah. Okay. I got mine already. And I got a good story for mine too.
All right, go ahead.
Okay, mine's goulash.
Okay.
Okay. It doesn't really just... It only describes the game in the fact that it's one of my most hated meals at this time in my life. It didn't used to be. Kind of like, this game has always been bad to me. But I hate goulash so much. Also, I hate this game so much. And let me tell you why I hate goulash. I've already told you why I hate the game. Let me now tell you why I hate goulash. So back in the day, my dad, growing up, we would make goulash. No big deal. Make goulash. Okay. We'll make it on a Monday, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we make it, it's got like macaroni noodles or whatever in it. It's got meat, macaroni. What typically you like? Macaroni, noodles, pasta sauce meat, or something, right? And some meat. Okay, so that's what it is on Monday. But he makes a giant pot of it. No way we can eat it on Monday.
So, all right, so we'll Tuesday.
We have leftovers on Tuesday. No big deal. Leftovers on Tuesday. Wednesday rolls around. It's starting to get a little ragged. So we should probably throw it out, right?
Right.
Not at my dad's house. Instead, let's like throw hot dogs in it and pour some more pasta sauce in there.
Oh,
maybe add some like tomatoes and like green peppers and stuff to it. Just heat it back up, stir it up.
There's
Wednesday.
It's got some more life. Okay.
Yeah, that's Wednesday. Oh, whoa, I'm not done. Thursday, there's still goulash, but now it's like this weird laboratory goulash.
Yeah.
And it's starting to get a little rank.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's starting to... Not very good for goulash on Thursday, but there's still plenty of it. So what are we going to do? Are we going to throw it away? Not in my dad's house. Instead, we're going to put it in a big pot with some beef broth and turn it into soup.
Oh, God. That's horrible.
So anyways, needless to say, if I ever had a chance of liking goulash, my dad squashed that.
It was over.
Ago.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I would describe this game.
Your love affair with goulash was over. So here's how I'll describe this game with a story about. So I really like chicken casserole, right? Big chicken casserole fan.
Huh. And who isn't?
Right. So, and there was one day in high school where we came down to the cafeteria. And the product looked like chicken casserole. I was like, oh, I'll eat some chicken casserole. I got that. It looks good, right?
Oh,
like
yeah.
This game looks pretty good graphically, right? Looks pretty good.
Yeah, looks good.
Okay. So, you know, get it, buy it, come over, sit down, get my big first big fork full, put it in my mouth. It's tuna casserole.
Tuna.
Oh no, not tuna casserole. Yeah, and so there you go. It looked good, looked like chicken casserole. The first bite, it was
Turns out tuna casserole.
Now,
I like tuna. I do not like tuna casserole.
I love tuna. Do not put tuna casserole on my face. No.
Especially not when it looks like chicken casserole.
Yeah, when you're, and that's one of the things. Me and my wife talk about this a lot. Like, there's nothing worse than, like, picking up the wrong drink. Not just – I'm not a germaphobe. I don't care about the germs. But if I'm expecting, like, to drink a sip of water and I get tea, or if I'm expecting Coke and I get tea or water, it's like
– Or backer spit, maybe?
Any surprise. It's just awful.
Barry, yep. Over that blanket.
It's
forget about the cat, though.
Oh, sorry about
so
that.
The audio only listeners, Justin's daughter wanted a blanket, and he just went to go get it for her, but the cat was laying on it and just slung the cat in the floor.
Yeah, it's almost midnight. She's still up. Anyway,
she's a trooper.
Yeah,
telling you, it's that Mountain Dew.
Yeah, that's right. But yeah, so, yeah.
Okay, so we know basically how we feel about this game, but I thought I would get a third party in on this, besides the listeners. I called up Nick Stevens,
yeah.
Genesis Gems, okay. And asked him what he thought about it, and here's his response.
But this is probably going to be like one of the most infamous sound bites you'll ever have from Nick Stevens, but this is probably one of my favorite games of all time, like probably.
Wow.
Yeah. Could you believe that?
Doesn't know how to.
I could.
He doesn't know how to pick them.
He doesn't really know how to pick them. I mean, he is on a Genesis podcast.
Right. Wow.
So.
It's a mess there, Nick. It's a mess.
I know. Oh, well. What are you going to do?
I don't know.
All right. So what did the listeners think about all this?
All right. So I got some Facebook feedback. And we'll start us off with Stephen Michael from Facebook. I feel like we haven't introduced him as Stephen Michael from Facebook in a while, right?
Yeah.
Said, it's another horrible game based on an 80s classic movie, LJN. What more do I need to say? Eric.
Not much.
Eric Purcell says, strange things are definitely afoot at the Circle K. Timmy Mac says, yes. It's my pick. What can I say? Growing up in the late 80s, a lot of my favorite movies were games on the NES, and most of them were terrible, LOL. This game I remember playing a ton. I tried to do a lot, like add story and dialogue options. The poor controls and unnecessary items did it no favors. So it was just me running around throwing pudding. It does have a pretty sweet manual. Well, I'm looking forward to the dudes having fun with this one. If you are... guys are really us, what number are we thinking of? Family friendly dudes.
6 and 9.
Right. Yeah.
That's in the movie, but right. It's not said like that. He did bring up another point that we forgot to mention in the game. There is dialogue tree kind of things when you talk to people sometimes, mm-hmm. where you actually have to pick what you want to say. The only kicker there is the controls don't make any sense. You push one of the A or the B button to cycle through, and then you push the other one to select the phrase you want to say instead of the D-pad to cycle through. And so I screwed that up almost every time I did it. So it didn't really matter to me.
Let's see. So Cecil Dredge says, I never had or played this title growing up, but I enjoyed the movies. I do own this cart now, and I guess it's time to give her a whirl. I'm interested to hear what the dudes take on it. Thumbs up. And then he comes back and says, another question for the dudes or D-batters. Who was your favorite historical figure Bill and Ted interacted with? Mine was Genghis Khan. George Carlin as Rufus was cool, too.
Is he mean in the movies or in this game? In the movies, I like Socrates, as they call
him. Yeah, he's pretty good. Socrates.
Yeah.
He's a pretty wise guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like how they had to when they had to talk to him all philosophy-fied, and they used music quotes, basically, to talk to him.
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny.
All right, Paul Biscaglia says, remember, it may be a horrible game, but not all the hate should go to LJN. They simply published it. Give the hate to Rocket Science Productions. You know what other classic they produced? The Mutant Virus. Want one more? I can't. They never developed another NES game after that. It was for the best. Which is true. I gave a lot of flack to LJN. But here's something that I didn't quite... Rocket Science didn't really ever make a lot of big-name games, but they did tend to work a lot with Sega. So
that explains it all.
Yeah. I'm just saying.
Okay.
All right. Back to the feedback. Tyler Jones, be excellent to each other and party on, dudes. Andrew Code says, never played the game, but loved the movies. If the dudes approve, I will seek the game out. As always,
Drew Bacco.
Yeah.
We do not approve.
As always. The power is yours. Steer my life. Well. Oh, and I can't wait for the third movie. And Chris Vanderhoff says, which will never happen.
And well, then, you can't believe anything Chris Vanderhoff says. So. Right.
And Andrew Code, like, gave a link about the third movie. And then they just kind of talked about the... third movie, maybe not may or may not coming. Anyway, Chris Vanderhoff comes back and says, excellent. I seem to recall renting this back in the day, but I'm sure it didn't have the manual. That could be why I remember this game sucking. Enlighten me, two dudes in a tangent. We've given you plenty of tangent.
We give you some really good tangents this episode, Chris.
And Peter Martin says, I'll insert what has seemed to become my line on most of these games. I never played it, nor knew anyone that had it. Looking forward to the pod, though. Dudes, be excellent to one another. Douglas DeLucky Jr. says, this game is so bad, even the LJN Defender struggled to give it love. Why is it that I want to say LGN?
I don't know.
It just rolls off my tongue. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
Dan Biscaglia says, I'd give it 3 bags and 2 small porcelain telephone booths. With movies like Keanu Reeves in them, you can't lose.
Okay.
And
it is a good movie.
Yeah. We're not knocking the movie. Just knocking the game. So, anyway. And Aaron Vander May says, I love the movie, but the game is nowhere as good as the movie. Haha. There are some positives. The graphics are decent. The main song is kind of catchy. And my favorite part of the game are all of the funny lines by Bill and Ted. Some things that bother me about this game. Why can't you walk or run in the grass? It's like they just wanted to make the game tougher or something. It's also a little confusing trying to figure out where to go and what you need to find. Even though this game is pretty rough around the edges, it's still a hilarious 8-bit trip back to the 80s. Still worth playing for a little while. So I think that was our first kind of positive review.
Yeah, and he also, I think it was him, and I apologize if it was actually somebody else, but he did a nice little Photoshop for us, if you want to see here.
Yeah, yeah.
You see that?
Mm,
it's
he did.
He changed it from Bill and Ted's to Two Dudes and an S on the logo for us, yeah, and posted that up. I thought that was cool. I might use that as a logo for the show or something.
Yeah, yeah. And then he comes back with, my retrofitted trophies for this game are 1, Bill S. Preston, Bookworm Esquire, collect 20 textbooks. And 2, Wild Stallion Rodeo, ride the horse for 60 seconds without falling off. Which we didn't even talk about. The horse was just ridiculous.
Mm, yeah.
Yeah, he said, keep up the great work, Two Dudes, party on, don't be heinous. All right. That's it.
Duly noted. That's it on the Facebook group. Let's see. I think I've got some other Facebook stuff. I've got a two-factor authorization that Facebook is making me do.
Oh,
that?
No.
I know. It's so frustrating. It's for my own protection, you know?
Right.
I guess while I'm pulling up the feedback that I have, we can talk about, let's talk about the Christmas episode, because the next episode we release is going to be a Christmas episode.
Woohoo!
Yeah. We've had requests to do another album.
Okay.
But honestly, that's a lot of work. I don't know that we could pull it off.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm willing to try. This weekend for me is pretty free. I could maybe write at least some music for about 3 or 4 songs.
Yeah.
If you can help me pull together some lyrics or something.
Let's do it.
In time to record. And we can try. We can see what happens. We'll do our best. If we can't pull a bunch of songs together, then I'm sorry. So that means then, if we're going to do a Christmas episode, going to do another radio broadcast type show, then we're going to need some calls.
Mm-hmm.
My suggestion is, last time we had people call in with Christmas memories, right?
Right.
This time, I think we should have people call in with their Christmas wish list.
Ooh.
Whether their wish list be an actual tangible item that they would like to have. Obviously, we probably won't be able to give them these things, but we'll pass it on to Santa. So
right.
You can get them. Like an NES game that they don't have in their collection they always wanted. Or maybe a topic that they would love for us to cover on the show is on their wish list. You know, something like that. You know, world peace. I'll accept world peace. Although that, good luck to you. I don't even think Santa can pull that one off.
No.
But anyways, what do you think?
I like
it. Pretty good topic. Okay. I'll post about it on Facebook maybe tomorrow. Asking for that. And people listening to this show, be sure to call in. Now, I guess, would be a good time to give out our number. But I'm not prepared to do so, so I won't. It's 7757-RETRO-1, which I'm not sure what that is off the top of my head.
Yeah.
7757-RETRO-1.
I think I'd know this by now, but I don't.
Yeah.
But anyway.
So we'll have people call in for that. We may also allow them to post and do like, so we can read them off.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess if we can pull it off, let's try.
Mm-hmm.
Let's try to do about 3 or 4 songs like we did last time. And unfortunately, we don't have Matthew to help us out this year because he lives in a different state now.
Yeah.
But we'll try to do it. Me and you, we'll try to pull it off. We'll do another radio broadcast. But it all hinges on if we can get the songs together and if we get enough calls. So you guys get a call with your wish list, your Christmas wish list, 2 or 3 items on your wish list. Wish list about the podcast or wish lists that you actually want in real life. Something you know. Anyways, you get it. Okay. I don't need to keep rambling on and on. All right. Back to the feedback.
Yeah. Seems like I had something. Go ahead.
You got something?
I don't have anything.
You got some crazy hair.
Oh, I do have a story about one of our Christmas stories that we keep like talking about. Matthew's boomerang.
Yeah.
So my mom went on vacation. She brings back a boomerang for my daughters.
Okay.
We take it outside. We're playing with it. We maybe get 10 good throws on it. I'm getting pretty confident with it, and I throw it really hard and put it on the roof.
Nice.
And there it remains. So.
Do you need a ladder?
Yeah. So I just haven't gone and got my dad's ladder.
Gotcha.
Put it up there yet. So.
Okay. Anyway. Well, maybe one day.
Yeah. Maybe one day. We'll get it. We'll eventually do it.
I swear, us non-Australians are just not meant to be throwing boomerangs.
It's okay. True.
Dude Gale, I need to know how to throw a boomerang.
Yeah. We really do.
Let us know. We need some help up in here. Excuse me. All right. Let's go back to feedback here. On the Facebook Honorary Dudes group. Jesse, Clev of it all, or the great dude, says, awesome. Dude Aaron Hickman says, great movie, shameful game. Dude Andy Lewis says, LJN, let's just not.
I like that.
And then Dude Gabe Van Gilder says, excellent. All right, Facebook page. Remember all those times I said we should really consolidate
right.
all of our different feedback things? Still haven't done that. All right. Anthony Pig says, I got this game several years ago in a box with other NES games. While it may not be the worst game I've played, I did have fun playing it. I don't remember too much about the movie, but I don't remember everyone in the time period scrambling for chocolate pudding. Tommy McKeenan says, I can't say anything about the game, but the movie Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey gave me some weird dreams as a kid. Loved it, though. Also, the first one when I got the chance to see it later on. Cameron Bruce Child says, the OST will make you poop your pants.
Okay.
And Stacy Sears says, most excellent.
Nice.
All right. Twitter. Got a little bit of feedback on Twitter. Mostly about the movie. But Paul and Andy at Power Trip Gaming, our good friends over there on the YouTubes.
Yeah.
Say, Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey was one of my favorite movies growing up. It made me want to face off against death, even if he wanted best 3 out of 5. Never played the game, though, and not looking forward to it. Well, Paul and Andy, I think I know what game you guys should probably try next.
Uh-huh. I think so.
I mean, you're always making us play things like Castle Quest and Legacy of the Wizard.
Yeah, really.
I think it's about time that we made a recommendation for you to play Bill and Ted's excellent video game adventure.
Yeah.
And then Baz says, love that second film. I think my favorite line, though, will always crack me up. It's when Evil Ted looks at the pics of princesses and says, oh, can't say that. But thank you, Baz.
Oh boy.
Okay, we'll stop the Twitter feedback there. Thank you for that the laugh there though, Baz.
Yeah.
If you want to look it up, go to our Twitter and you can look it up. It's pretty funny. All right, Google Plus. Ryan Ballard says, I really enjoyed the flicks as a kid, but I'm doubting they aged very well. Well, as I mentioned earlier, the flicks themselves don't age all that well, but the death board game scene does.
Yeah. So says you.
Yeah, so says me. So I got to... Okay, we're running a little long.
Uh-huh.
We've still got the holiday pie off, but there's a lot of voicemails for that. I'm thinking save it for the Christmas episode.
Dude, yeah, I think Christmas episode would be a good time to talk about pie.
Yeah, I agree. We can talk about pie on the Christmas episode because we won't be talking about a game that episode.
Right.
All right, so I do have two emails, one iTunes review, and John Wedgeworth has corrected us on something.
All right. Here we go.
And then we're done.
All right.
So John Wedgeworth, hailing from Iowa, he's a natural Iowan. Is that how you say it?
Uh-huh.
What is it? Is it?
Island? Yeah, it's Island.
Okay. So, we were talking about where, I don't remember what episode it was. It was either Castle Quest or the one before. We were talking about where Tom Arnold is from.
Mm-hmm.
And we were struggling to pronounce Otumwa or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Well, John has courageously offered up his services. And this is how you're supposed to pronounce it. As a native Iowan. Okay, maybe I should turn my volume up here.
Otumwa.
Hear that?
I got it. Otumwa.
Otumwa.
Otumwa. Otumwa. Right?
Yeah.
So now Tom Arnold might actually come on the show. Now that we know how to pronounce his home. Okay, email number one. This email comes from... I'm not sure. I forgot. Or I didn't clip it right. So, but thank you. I'll try to remember maybe next episode, probably not, but you'll know who you are. It says, "Hey, first time reaching out to you all. I just started listening to the podcast about 6 months ago, and I have really enjoyed the show. Just finished episode 118 today and liked the idea of picking a list of games under $118, which I've included below. Huge Zelda 2 fan and by far my favorite game on the NES. Keep up the great work. You dudes rock." So his list, for anybody who's curious, is Zelda 2, Castlevania 3, Contra, Metroid, Faxanadu, Golgo 13, TMNT, Super Mario Bros. 2, which I think pretty darn good list.
Yeah, it is.
So, yeah. Thank you, dude. Or whoever you are. I guess you're probably not a dude yet. Probably not a dude yet because it's only 6 months ago. You've only been listening for 6 months. It's hard to get dude ship that quickly.
That's real personal. Thank you. Whoever you are.
Okay, I got to look it up. I got to look it up because I feel bad. I see I screen capped it instead of actually pulling up the actual email. That was a mistake.
I like it.
And I don't think I'm entirely over my sickness because I don't know if you've noticed, but throughout this episode, my voice has just kind of started fading away. So I hope everybody can accept my apology for my loss of voice.
They won't.
No, they never do. All right. I'm going to look at...
Got it.
Oh boy, this is a real good podcasting right here.
Yeah, this is a great pod.
I love it. Dennis. That was from you, Dennis. I'm okay. Sorry, I didn't remember that.
Thank you, Dennis.
And then Chris. I don't know which Chris this is, or if this is a new Chris, old Chris, but his email says, "They're not spikes, dudes. It's 2D. They are razor blades." And that's in reference to Castle Quest, because you can't run into the sides of them, you know?
Yeah.
So thanks for that correction. And the iTunes review, and then you're going to have to finish this out because my voice is fading.
All right.
The iTunes review. This is a doozy, because it is not a winner. Okay?
Oh, no.
This is not one of our best iTunes reviews. Okay, you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. It's a 2-star.
Another 2-star.
Yeah, this is actually going to be pretty funny to you. I don't know why they give us 2 stars. This is from Tiki Baby 2000. The title of the review is Aloha with a little one of these numbers. I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
The little thumb and pinky move.
Mm-hmm.
And a bunch of smiley faces doing this. You know, they have both hands raised. Yeah. Okay. That's the title of the review. It's 2-star. I almost want to think this is a joke, but at the same time, it doesn't really feel like a joke. So if this is you listening out there, Tiki Baby, this is really your review, this is not a joke, tell us and maybe change your two. You may have accidentally given us 2-star because I think this is supposed to be a 5. All right. Here we go. It says, "My dad listens to you all the time and you guys are very interesting and funny. When I am on my phone, I hear my dad listening to you, and I listen and I laugh because you are funny and interesting to listen to, and I'll look forward to listening to you sometime soon with my dad. My favorite NES game is King's Quest V because I love the graphics and the music. I hope you have a wonderful life. Love, Carly. I'm 11 years old and I live in Hawaii. I rated you 5 million stars.
Ah.
Thank you, Carly.
Thank you, Carly. I'm not even mad about the 2-star.
No. I mean, because really, the translation there, or the currency exchange, is 2 stars equals 5 million stars.
Right.
So she technically gave us 5 million stars.
Yeah.
So that's our latest iTunes review.
That is awesome.
That's adorable.
I'll take it.
All right. So. And I'm done. I'm cashed. I'll say goodbye when it's all said and done. But if you don't care to finish this out.
Well, you know, you can find us on Facebook or Twitter. Look us up. Go to iTunes. Give us a review. You can always send us an email. You can check us out on our website. TwoDudesInANS.com, NintendoDudes.com, and NESDudes.com. And you can always call us at, can you do the number? 775-7-RETRO-1.
Here, I'll look it up. You finish.
It's 775-7-RETRO-1.
Yeah, say something about the website and then how you can call from the website.
So
say something
call,
about the Fox dude and the Wii dude.
You could just say
I'll
that.
I'll look it up.
No, you're good to say
no,
that.
No, I'm telling you, I'm losing my voice.
Yeah,
okay.
Right, exactly.
No, you got to say it.
Right,
I'm trying
right,
to get you to
okay,
say it.
Exactly. So shout out to the Fox dude for our graphics, the Wii guy for our music. Obviously, they're awesome and all that they've done for us. And you can go to our website. If you go to the website on the mobile app, you can click the phone in the top right-hand corner. And when you do that, it calls us. And you can leave a voicemail for us to be read on an episode, probably mid-2019 at this point. But it will be, you know, we'll play it at some point.
No, we'll do it on the Christmas episode.
Right.
Make your Christmas wish list and call it in.
Right.
All right, so that number is actually 775-7-7-3-8-7-6-1. I just did it with the alphanumerics. Hopefully that works.
Yes.
Because I don't know. I don't have the app installed on my phone anymore for some reason.
All right.
All right. I think that's it.
Yep.
I'm fading fast.
Well, go fade to bed. We've got a long episode here for a game like this.
Yeah, we did. We did it.
Yeah. All right. All right. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.